All right, we're gonna get started. Thank you all so much for introducing yourselves and keep doing so if you haven't done. Hi, my name is Anjali. I'm Climate Justice Lead at Sierra Club BC. I am thrilled to be joined here by Joel Bakan and Kshama Sawant. I'll introduce them in just a second, but first I wanted to acknowledge that we are doing this event, or I'm tuning into this event from the unceded territories of the Squamish, Musqueam, and Tsleil-Waututh people. And these are unceded and sovereign territories that we are privileged to do this work upon. And that needs to factor into our work. And that's something that we strive for at Sierra Club BC, and something that I'm striving for in my life as well. If you don't know which territories you are tuning in from, and if you're in Canada, you can visit native-land.ca. And it's a territory map, so you can see whose territories you're on. I don't know actually of the equivalent south of the border, but there actually might be some, there might be some US territories there as well. So thanks so much for joining us. I would like to introduce my fellow panelists who I'm absolutely thrilled to have with me here today. Actually, before I do that, let me just run through a couple of housekeeping things. So today we'll be using the chat and the Q&A box, and those are two different things. So at the bottom of your screen, you should see a little icon that says Q&A. And if you have any questions for the panelists at any time, please put your questions in there, because if you put them in the chat box, we probably won't see them. And your question might get answered live by one of our panelists, or it might get answered by one of our amazing team that will type an answer for you. So please use the Q&A box. And other comments and general conversation can happen in the chat box on your right. We would love to also just remind people that, you know, we're talking about a heavy topic, and we're talking about something that is polarizing. And so we need everyone to keep it respectful and kind and constructive and forward looking. So please, no hate speech. It won't be tolerated, and you'll be kicked out. And nothing unpleasant, please. Let's keep it constructive. I also want to acknowledge that we're doing this event at a time of great heaviness in the world right now. So I just want to name that in light of the violence and the displacement of the Palestinian people. That's really heavy on my mind. And my family's in India right now as well, where India is facing its worst health crisis in recent history. So I know that many of you are also feeling this heaviness. So I just wanted to name that, and name that what we're talking about here today is something ultimately very hopeful, and hopefully a place that we can draw strength to move forward and onward to a better world together. So without further ado, I just want to introduce the panelists. So we have Kshama Sawant with us today, and Kshama is an activist and a city councilor in Seattle, south of the border. And I will let Kshama speak more about her background in a bit, but she's made an incredible journey from movement building and activism into the halls of power in Seattle City, where she is with the Socialist Alternative Party, and fighting for rent control and corporate taxation in an environment that is very polarized. And she has Amazon and other companies after her, and you're being so brave in the face of that. So we'll hear more about what Kshama's facing in Seattle City and in the US as a whole. So thank you so much, Kshama, for being here. We're so honored to have you. And we have Joel Bakan, also so thrilled that Joel could join us. Joel is one of the filmmakers of The New Corporation, which many of you just watched. He's also an author and a musician and a law professor at UBC. His work examines the social, economic, and political dimensions of law. And he is, he's the filmmaker of the original corporation movie that came out in 2003, which sent waves across the world. So we are so thrilled that you can be here, Joel. So let's kick things off. I just want to hear from both our panelists and give them a chance to introduce themselves. So maybe we can start with Kshama. And Kshama, I would just love to know, and I'm sure many people are wondering, how you journeyed from activism to running for politics, and what led you to do that, and a little bit about your background.
Thank you, Anjali, first of all, for including me in this conversation, and so delighted to be here alongside Joel, whose brilliant film captures not only the problems of our time and the historic questions that are facing humanity, but also that there is hope and that people can get organized and fight back and win. I think that was a very important part of the message. And that's also the message of the Sierra Club that you are a part of, Anjali, and Socialist Alternative that I'm a part of, where we're not here just to have intellectual conversations, but to really examine how we can bring about actual change. And I think that was also the underlying question behind my own journey. And I think the only real value in sharing my story is I think it's that it will resonate with a lot of other people. It's not unique in any way. In fact, its power lies in the fact that so many millions of young people are questioning society around them. I think I grew up with the same idea. I grew up in India, in that sliver of middle class that where both my parents worked really, really hard every single day to give my sibling and I something to hope for. So we had a relatively stable life, but I was surrounded by this sort of contrast with just an absolute ocean of poverty and misery faced by hundreds of millions of Indian people. And then on the other hand, you had a small number of people at the top who were obviously consolidating all the wealth and the gains of society. And so I think I grew up with with a burning desire to change something. And, everybody has to have that passion, because without that passion at the starting point, then what are we as human beings? But it wasn't just that, it was also, and I think this is how, what will resonate with a lot of people as well, is that it wasn't just the passion to bring about some change, but it was also a logical questioning that, none of the explanations that are offered as to why there are these endemic problems of poverty, and why is it that when humanity has reached such pinnacles of technological innovation that we are still facing billions of people having malnutrition? And so all the answers that were offered to me were completely unsatisfactory. Oh, it's karma, people just, have done something bad in their past life, or it's just the way it is. I was also accused of being immodest and sort of arrogant for thinking that it could be different. You should just put your head down, work on your career, go get a good job, get a good education, and so on. So I was, on a search for answers about the world from the very beginning. And then, of course, when I came to the US, it was also a second sort of, second stage of eye opening, where even the richest country in humanity has not been able to solve those problems. That helped me connect it, all of it, to the questions of capitalism. That's what led me to become a member of Socialist Alternative. And last thing I'll add is I never set out to be a political figure or an elected representative. We actually democratically decided to run a campaign, and who the candidate should be, what the campaign should be like, we're all part of a democratic decision.
I'm so excited to dig more into that. Thank you so much, Kshama. And I'll pose the same question to Joel. The first movie came out 17 years ago. So the link between you two and what we're here to talk about is the corporation, examining exactly what this entity is that's running our world. So what was the reason you wanted to make that first film, and what's the journey been like into this film? Oh, you're muted.
Yeah. I originally got into law because I was interested in justice, and it didn't take long, I would say the first minute of law school, to realize that at least in the mainstream world, those two things weren't connected. And I kind of knew that because I had studied Marx quite thoroughly and seriously as an undergraduate, and Karl Marx had some very interesting takes on the law. He saw it as basically an ideological superstructure that helped justify, legitimate, make natural and normal a system that was actually horrendously unjust, namely capitalism. And so I kind of have looked at law from that perspective throughout my career and tried to go a step further, I guess, or not further, but try to take Marx's original idea into our contemporary legal system and to look at institutions like property rights and contract rights and corporations, all of which do serve that role that Marx talked about of helping make seem normal and natural. I mean, we all talk about property as though it's part of nature, but it isn't. Property is a legal relation that's created by the state under pressure from capital. And so I try to look at these legal concepts in that way. And it does go a bit further and in some ways more troubling than Marx thought, because they aren't just ideological justifications, but they're actual material realities in a way that there's a materiality to law because it has the entire coercive apparatus of the state behind it. And so what I'm really interested about, and I'll just stop there, is how while right-wingers and free marketers and corporate elites and all those people keep saying, we don't want the state, we want to minimize the state, all of that, what I'm interested in is how they ask the state, demand the state to protect their rights under the guise of saying that they think the state should be minimalized. What they're really saying is minimalize the state to the extent it protects the people from us, capital, but maximize the coercive force of the state to protect our interests. And there's no better example of that than the corporation. It's a legal structure that basically legalizes the values of capitalism and puts the coercive force of the state behind it. So that's kind of the geeky academic way I came to this. And I was writing a book that basically looked at things that way. And I was kind of hit like a brick with this contradiction. I think Kshama talked about not just wanting to talk about things intellectually. And I was an intellectual talking about things intellectually. I realized I'm talking about changing the world to five people who are members of the academic elite. This just seemed to be a real contradiction. And so I thought I needed to sort of take my thinking, these ideas that were rooted in Marx and many others and socialist thought and whatnot. And I need to figure out a way to get them out in to the people that I was sort of concerned to be working for in my work rather than just within the academy. And so that's what the first film and book, The Corporation, came out of. And that's what the sequel film and the sequel book, which is available at booksellers everywhere, including that large online retailer that we all hate. So that's what kind of led me to try to write in a way and produce culture, to be a cultural worker in a kind of activist way that rather than a purely intellectual and academic way.
I love the framing of that, Joel, and we're seeing, you know, some support in the chat. I think that framing is really helpful. The corporation is a legal structure that legalizes the laws of capitalism, which they seek to have upheld by the state. So that kind of goes into this. So I work for Sierra Club BC, and you know, we're part of the environmental movement. The environmental movement has been begging governments to take action on the environment for so long. You know, the target is usually political decision makers. And we watch our governments stuck in this deadlock where they, you know, they're being pulled by corporations on one side and pulled by us on the other side. And, you know, it's these like opposing interests, and we watch governments continue to make decisions that place profit over people. So you're right in that it's not that corporations think that governments shouldn't exist and corporations should run the world. They need government to work in their favor. So, I mean, this is something that we'll discuss. How do we loosen that deadlock? How, you know, it shouldn't be governments serving corporations. It should be governments and corporations serving the people. Kshama knows this better than anyone else. Kshama, I'd love to ask you, you know, you have been on Seattle City Council for some time now, a few years now, right? And so there's a recall campaign against you that has a lot of, you know, it seemingly has a lot of support online, a lot of, you know, sort of puppet Twitter accounts set up and a lot of corporate money. Amazon has invested over a million, probably more than that, into this recall campaign. Can you speak about your experience and why do they want you out of office so badly? And what does it say that Amazon is interfering or participating in a political process to get you out of power?
Thanks for asking that question, Anjali. And in fact, I think a lot of that fundamentally also ties into the very important points that Joel made about the nature of government, or as I would call it, nature of the state under capitalism. You know, the process that Joel was describing about how right wingers and big business want the government to work for them, but not for ordinary people and for working people. That sort of takes into account the unshakable reality under capitalism that it's a zero sum game. Meaning, if corporations and the wealthy are gaining, it is only gain at the expense of the rest of us. So there's no universe under capitalism where they're becoming $1 trillion richer during the pandemic and we are also doing well under the pandemic. No, the fact that 500 people became over $1 trillion richer happened because it was the year of unprecedented crisis for the rest of us, where so many millions of American workers, Canadian workers, people on every continent lost their jobs, lost their incomes. And so the interests of ordinary people, billions of ordinary people on this planet, and the needs of the planet and of humanity as a whole are completely counterposed to the endless greed of big business and the wealthy under capitalism. And so it is, you know, the system as it exists is presented as a conflict for us. So when you have working people win a position for that will represent their interests unambiguously, such as our council office. And you're right, Anjali, we've been in office since 2014. We won our first election in 2013. But when that happens, it's not like, oh, it's all government and we're somehow going to find a harmonious way to exist and then go towards common goals. It doesn't work that way because the state under capitalism is primarily set up to serve the interests of big business, whether it is visible to us at a given moment or not. Always the wealth and power that is consolidated by the billionaire class, multimillionaires, that power is what speaks in the halls of government, whether it's city hall, state legislatures, or US Congress. And this is true globally. I mean, obviously there are differences because of different trajectories of social movements. For example, Canada has healthcare. The US does not have any form of social healthcare. But the point is that for the most part, global capitalism, the government under global capitalism functions as the state apparatus of capitalist interests. And so when working people win in the rare instances that they win an office like ours, where we are unambiguously fighting for workers, it immediately pits our office and the movements we're building in conflict with big business. It's not like Jeff Bezos and the billionaires and the democratic establishment here, for example, the political establishment that controls the city. They said, oh, you know what? That's great. We welcome working people having their own office. We'll make sure that we work together with you. No, from day one, it was posed as a conflict. So what we've seen in the last 7.5 years is that because we use our office as an organ of social struggle, we have had unprecedented success, you know, making Seattle winning the first $15 minimum wage in the country. We won the Amazon tax last year, which is a tax on Amazon and other big businesses to fund affordable social housing and Green New Deal projects. And in the interim, we have won a whole host of renters' rights that were thought of as impossible. But what that has meant is that big business, wealthy people, and the democratic establishment, which primarily serves the interests of the wealthy, have done everything in their power to undermine us every which way. You know, obviously, including campaigning against us in a big way in 2019 when we were running for our second re-election, they threw everything and the kitchen sink at us. As you said, Amazon's spent, you know, threw down $1 million money bomb in the last months of the election in order to, you know, do a corporate takeover of City Hall. They didn't succeed. They have filed lawsuits after lawsuits against us. They have filed ethics complaints after ethics complaints against my office. They've used every kind of racist and sexist and xenophobic trope against us. They sent 27 mailers attacking me personally in 2019. It's unbelievable with sexist and racist overtones, you know, the angry brown woman trope. The point is that nothing worked and we are still here. And after we won our second re-election, we won the Amazon tax last year in the midst of the Black Lives Matter street protests. And so that's why the recall, you know, the recall is basically just their latest and the most blatant attempt to try and defeat the victories that social movements have won. And I will just say one other thing is that the recall is not against me personally. We should not make the mistake of seeing this as some sort of personality conflict or just against me, like they hate me. Obviously they hate me, yes, because they know where I stand. But what they really fear and what they're going after is not me personally, but the example of empowering ordinary people. You know, ordinary people can get organized. We can win. That is what we have shown. And that example is the most deadly for the ruling class, because the moment we lose our fears, we lose our chains. You know, that's, they want us to keep it. As Joel was saying, they want us to believe the system is the best that can be possible. We should not be dreaming about anything different. But when we actually show we can win, that's no longer even dreams. It's starting to be a reality. And that's what's scary for the ruling class under capitalism. And that's why they're trying to unseat us.
Wow. I mean, I'm sure most of the people who watched the film were also blown away by what you've been able to achieve together in Seattle. And it just shows, you know, the power is in the organizing. So Kshama, I would just follow with that. How do we build, or how do we begin to build a movement that can scare a corporation like Amazon?
I think the fundamental need for our movements in order to, as you said, build the kinds of movements that will actually put the fear in corporations like Amazon is one for us to recognize that among working people, obviously experiences are different. Different sections of our society experience different kinds of oppression because that's the way capitalism works. And a capitalist, it benefits capitalism to divide those who are exploited and oppressed into different degrees of exploitation. Hence, you see entrenched sexism and racism under capitalism. And it's like Malcolm X said, you cannot have capitalism without racism. So there's no hope of ending oppression without building a real momentum to end capitalism itself internationally. So we will need international solidarity. And that international solidarity has to look like multiracial working class solidarity, where we are all together as working people, as ordinary people who have a different vision of society, united against all of these oppressions and uniting in our shared interests, because we do have a shared interest because we are all being exploited. So whether you are white or black doesn't mean that you don't face different oppressions. Of course we do. And we need people of all races to stand, for example, in the United States against black oppression and against police violence, but that it's that unity among working class people that is absolutely crucial. And in a small way, that's what we've shown in Seattle. Obviously, our victories have been limited to citywide victories, but what we have shown is that when we bring working people together in that kind of united struggle against our common enemy of this system itself, of big business and all the politicians and the endless media operatives and all these political pundits who repeat, you know, who shill for the system, we recognize that they are all against us and we have to build a united struggle. That is when we have any hope of winning. And I think we also have to understand that there is, it's not so much that, you know, a lot of people will ask, you know, how do we convince people that we need to fight? I'll be honest. At this moment, if you look at millions of young people in the United States and Canada, for example, I don't think that we have to convince them that the system is not working for them, right? If that was true, then how would 26 million Americans come out on the streets in multiracial working class solidarity against black oppression and police violence to make the largest protest movement ever in US history? No, that's not what the problem lies. The problem lies in where's the leadership? So, you know, ultimately, the answer to your question also includes the question of the left overall, not just in the US and Canada, but internationally, taking its historical responsibility seriously and showing actual leadership to build that kind of unity, but the right kind of unity, not unity with big business and their politicians, unity on the ground with ordinary people.
Yes, okay, so on this question of unity, and Joel, I want to toss it to you. Kshama's talking about the need for us to understand our shared interest and how that shared interest is diametrically opposed to our common enemy of the corporation and of the capitalist system that it upholds. In your journey of doing these two films, how does the corporation contribute to the undermining of that shared unity? How does it convince us that we're different, that we don't have shared interests? And how does it, you know, basically contribute to the breakdown of our movements in that way?
Yeah, I mean, I think the contemporary corporation is inseparable from capitalism. I mean, a corporation doesn't have to be capitalist. You can have the U.S. Post Office is not a capitalist corporation. It's a corporation with the mandate to serve various public interests. We have crown corporations, municipalities are corporations, but the for-profit publicly traded corporation is, as I mentioned before, a legalization of the fundamental principle of capitalism, that capitalism is about accumulating, creating as much capital as you can by extracting it from people's labor and from the earth. I mean, that's how you make capital. You extract resources, whether human resources or natural resources, and you turn that into profit through, you know, surplus value, as it's called. And I think the real problem is, I mean, I think Kshama really sort of hit the nail on the head here in talking about conflict. The real problem is we're being schooled to believe there isn't conflict. I mean, that's what social responsibility, sustainability, that's what it's all about. It's corporations saying, hey, we're all in the same boat. We care about the environment. You care about the environment. There's shared value. That's a term you see a lot in the corporate world. There are win-win solutions. We can do well by doing good. All of this is an attempt to mask the fact that there is class conflict. What is class conflict? Class conflict is that a very small number of people own the vast majority of capital. That's class conflict, and everybody else doesn't. And the everybody else, a starting point for the everybody else, whether the concerns are racism or the concerns are the environment or the concerns are sexism, all of these things intersect with class. It's the power of class that is funneled through all those different things. Why is it that a large company can chop down trees or put, you know, effluent into the river or put carbon into the air? It's because they have control over those things that enable them to create profit and make wealth for their shareholders. So that is a class. And so people work so hard to try to diminish the power of class as a conflict, but it is very, very powerful because it explains why those few people have power over everybody else. So the everybody else have a common interest in challenging that power. And again, that is what unites. That is the sort of glue that ties together all of these different social movements, including the environmental movement, is we're all challenging the abuse, the exploitation, the harm that's being done by the capitalist class. And so a lot of people say, oh, well, are you saying we should get rid of capitalism? And I agree with Kshama, yes. Does that mean we have to get rid of markets? Not necessarily. So let me explain something. Capitalism says, I mean, the word, what does the word say? It says the ism is capital. So we've created this whole society where our goal is to create capital. Now, I think, you know, if people or whatever came down from Mars and they looked at that and they said, so how'd you organize your society? Well, we put it together in this way. We decided that a few people who owned capital should be enabled to make more and more of it. And that would be the entire goal of the society. So we called it capitalism. We put the ism onto the word capital. That's ridiculous. Like, why should we do that? Socialism puts the ism onto the word social. It says we're trying to help the public interest, the social, the good. So that makes a lot more sense to me. So then the question is, what happens to markets? And I guess the answer is we can have debates about this. Is there a place for markets within socialism? And we can debate. We can say, well, maybe they're a tool for organizing production in limited ways. Maybe even corporations are tools within socialism. It's a debate, it's a discussion. But I think we can all agree that the ultimate goal of society should not be the creation of capital with the assumption that maybe a little bit of good will trickle down from allowing all that capital to funnel up. I mean, that just doesn't make any sense at all. So for the people who are really struggling, is, are we saying we have to end capitalism? I think the answer is yes, I agree with Kshama. But in a way, you know, that doesn't, there are lots of varieties of ways of doing that. What we have to end is the idea that capital is the final, ultimate, only legitimate goal for all of our social production, for how we deal with the environment, for how we deal with everything else.
Mm-hmm. Okay, that's really interesting because that's often the debate, right? It's like markets, and you know, if we get rid of markets, how do we create things for the good of the whole? So that's, I mean, I think that's a whole other panel discussion. I'm kind of curious about, so if you take climate change, this large global challenge, and, you know, the film talks a lot about deregulation. Corporations have been pushing to not be regulated, which is what allows them, what gives them the power to sort of extract in the most harmful ways possible, to cause so much damage and destruction. What does an actual, in a strong response, in our ideal strong response to climate change as a global challenge, what is the role of the corporation? What is the role of government? And, you know, how, what would be our strongest foot forward for climate right now? I know that's a really broad question. I know we, you know, we need to control the power of corporations, but then what is the role of government in a strong response to climate change?
Kshama, do you want to?
No, go ahead.
I'm happy. Okay. I mean, so, you know, there's science, and science is fairly consensual on what needs to be done, what needs to be stopped, what needs to be started, how it needs to be done, green energy, you know, all of this kind of stuff. And so at a very, I mean, I'll give a very abstract answer to your abstract question. At a very sort of 33,000 feet up way, what needs to happen is we need public policy that reflects the science, that ensures that the planet doesn't burn up, and that takes particular regard for people who are most vulnerable in equatorial regions, in the global south, near, you know, on islands that are threatened to be engulfed by the sea, like all. So there's a strong, as we show in the film, I mean, there's a strong sort of equity component. There's a colonialism component. Again, all of these things mesh together. But there's a lot of research, there's a lot of work, and there's a lot of science on who is vulnerable, how they're vulnerable, what needs to be done, how we need to phase out fossil fuels, how fast we need to phase out fossil fuels, how soon green energy can come on tap. And what all of it shows is there is a path forward. But right. There is not a chance, there is no way in the world that all of this corporate talk of offsets, of ESG, of sustainability, of social responsibility, of Larry Fink saying we have to, you know, get out of coal. All of these corporate leaders, I mean, climate is the issue du jour for them, right? You would think that they were activists from the way they're talking. But because of that class issue, because of the legal constitution of the corporation, there is no way in the world that left to their own devices, the corporate sector will ever do what needs to be done in terms of what the scientists are telling us to stop right. this world from being destroyed. They will pursue a path that says something like this: we will go as far as we can to protect the climate until it challenges our bottom line. We can only find win-win solutions. Well, that means they have to win. But the climate is going to lose because there's no way that they can continue to make profit in the way they are and follow what scientists are saying. So what does government have to do? Government has to take sovereignty for the people. That's what democracy is. It's sovereignty for the people. And that means that government has to pursue policy, pursue science that takes an approach like we've seen, you know, some governments take with the pandemic. It's an emergency. It has to be dealt with as an emergency, and it has to be solved through public, democratic, sovereign governments. Now, that's a tall order because governments are in the pocket of industry. But let me put it this way. There is no way it's going to be solved by corporations. When they're doing their job properly, their main job is to make money. And so they're not going to solve climate. Governments are at least institutionally capable of doing what needs to be done. But what we need is to get government in the way that people like Kshama are trying to do what democratic government is supposed to do. Right. That's our only hope. I'm not saying it will pan out, but it's our only hope.
Yeah. And there's a deep short-sightedness to capitalism in that sense as well, because it relies on that endless exploitation. But what happens when there's nothing left to exploit? What happens when the ecosystems start to die? And, you know.
Yeah, but that's four quarters ahead, and most capitalists don't think that far ahead.
Right. Yeah. I just want to throw to, Kshama, did you want to add anything to that?
Yeah, I think I'm just, first of all, just wanted to say I really appreciate the points that Joel brought up, and including the last point that, you know, that nothing that is not directly related to the profit bottom line of the capitalists will be incorporated by them. And there's a reason why in Econ 101, you know, anybody who's taken economics classes will know that the environmental consequences of doing business are externalized. You know, they're presented as externality. I mean, that itself, mm-hmm. we can see how completely broken the paradigm of capitalism is in order to actually deal with climate justice. But I just wanted to add a couple more points. I mean, as Joel said, it's absolutely true. There is now undeniable, and has been for many years now, undeniable consensus, not only among climate scientists, but ordinary people. Billions of ordinary people understand. Many are actually on the front lines of facing immediate crisis. We are already seeing, mass problems of, you know, refugee crisis. The concept of climate refugee is now a reality already. And so there's no question about what needs to be done. I mean, there's no doubt about what needs to be done. That is not under debate here as far as the intellectual understanding of climate scientists is concerned. They're very clear. We are already on the precipice of complete catastrophe. And if we want to avoid that catastrophe, then today, yesterday, we should have done something. So there's no, in terms of science, I don't think that that's where the real debate lies. The question is exactly what Joel was going to earlier, which is, how do we make this happen on the basis of capitalism? And that's where I think it's no longer a question. It becomes no longer a question of discussing the science, but more about discussing politics. Like, how would we actually save the planet? That becomes a political question, and it turns into a political struggle. So fighting for the planet is actually a political struggle against capitalism. Because if you look at the statistics, only 100 corporations are responsible, you know, going back to the theme of this film, only 100 corporations are responsible for over 70% of the greenhouse gas emissions since 1988. And, not only what's happened for decades, but just weeks ago, it was reported by the Guardian newspaper that the world's biggest 60 banks have provided nearly $4 trillion of new financing for fossil fuel companies since the Paris climate deal in 2015. So in other words, despite the plummeting use of energy during the pandemic, you know, the stay at home period, overall funding for fossil fuel projects remains on an upward trajectory, and the finance provided last year was higher than the finance provided in previous years. I mean, this is absolutely stunning, and it is what shows that at the end of the day, this the climate crisis, and indeed the survival of the planet, is not going to happen on the basis of capitalism. Really, under capitalism, human society is on an unavoidable death march. That is not a matter of if or when, but how bad and in what manner the catastrophe is going to unfold. And this is why it becomes a political question. I mean, Anjali, you asked, what is the role of government? I mean, ultimately, yeah, what the government should be doing is clear. But why is this not happening under capitalism? Because for the most part, the state, the government, represents the interests of capitalism. The capitalist state represents the interests of capitalism. And we have no option but to concretely talk about the need to take the commanding heights of the economy into public ownership, meaning the big fossil fuel companies, Amazon, all of these big corporations. If we don't take those corporations into democratic public ownership by workers, by the community, there is no hope of making this change happen. So even for people who may not be comfortable about, oh, does capitalism have to end? I mean, one thing I would say is, well, why shouldn't it? Because capitalism wasn't like an edict from God. It has existed only for a few hundred years. And when it came into being, at that time, there were people arguing that feudalism and aristocracy should never end, and capitalism is, you know, so in that sense, at that moment, capitalism played a progressive role in the progress of humanity, but now it is completely defunct. It's not serving the questions that face us. And so, yes, it is a question of making progress, and getting out of capitalism and going to a different system is posed. Most concretely, I mean, it's posed in no matter what question you raise about social and economic justice, but perhaps most starkly and urgently posed in relation to climate change. Workers will need to get organized to take fossil fuel companies into democratic public ownership, not to continue the fossil fuel, but to keep the fossil fuel buried in the ground and retool the companies post haste into producing clean, renewable energy and actually working for humanity.
Exactly. You said it. Kshama just outlined the roadmap. Okay, I hope we're taking notes. And I think we have a few questions, Kshama, that I would love to follow up with. I'd love to throw to some questions from the audience now, because I think they relate to that. So there's a question here about what you just talked about, Kshama. What does the climate crisis offer to creating solidarity against the corporation? And I would add to that, what does the pandemic offer to creating solidarity against the corporation? And it's for either of you who want to speak to that.
Sure. I mean, I just picking up on what Kshama was saying about how, you know, there are many, many people on the front lines of the disaster of the climate crisis who I think are being activated out of necessity because, you know, whether they're climate refugees or whether they're living on island nations that are threatened with being engulfed by the sea. So there are many, many people. And then there are many people who may not be directly threatened, but see their future as being under attack. And we showed in the film these massive demonstrations by children, by young people around climate, school strikes, all those kinds of things. And I think that, you know, you raised the pandemic, and, you know, we look at the pandemic. We were doing that part of the film, and I was writing that part of my book fairly early in the pandemic at a time, and we spoke with Kshama about this actually, at a time when it did seem that it was really, even though people couldn't protest in the streets, it was kind of creating a new ethos. For the first time, it felt like the neoliberal presumptions were kind of broadly under attack. For the first time, you know, remember Bill Clinton said it's the economy, stupid. And that phrase looks stupid in light of the pandemic, because people were like, wait a minute, it's human life. It's like we have to act in a way that's going to protect the most vulnerable people from dying. Like that was sort of what people were saying. Lots of people. What editorialists were saying, mainstream media. So there was this moment where sort of real values of humanity started to seem to bubble to the surface and to make the shibboleths of neoliberalism seem ridiculous and mean-spirited. That and I think that's still happening in a way. I mean, corporations have kind of pushed back against that, and the media has, and you don't see it as much, but I think it was a watershed moment, and one that will carry into other crises like climate. I think part of the problem with climate is for many people, it still feels like an abstraction. Well, that's not going to last very long. It's not going to feel, I mean, if you live in Vancouver or Seattle, every summer, there are large sort of pieces of the summer where you can't even see the end of your block because of smoke from forest fires. So, I mean, I think that people know, nobody's being sort of immunized from the effects of climate anymore. So I think that's going to have a very powerful organizing effect, because people are just going to think we have to do something. And those who are organizing will have success because that idea will be in people's minds. I think the other thing is the link between climate and the pandemic. As we talk about in the film, there is a strong link between the pandemic, zoonotic disease, and loss of habitation for animals, the destruction of forests, all of those kinds of things. And it's shocking to me how little you see in the mainstream media that actually talks about that very obvious, direct, and uncontroversial science, that these kind of pandemics are created by environmental destruction. There's just a very, very close link between those things, but nobody's talking about it. And I think that message could be very powerful in terms of, again, making people realize that climate change is not an abstraction, that the extent to which it's forests are being destroyed and habitats for animals are being destroyed are going to lead to a chain of these pandemics that could be really, really horrific in terms of our future. In direct sort of parallel and connected to symbiosis with climate change and with environmental destruction. So I think, I don't want to celebrate the fact that we are in such an existential crisis, but I think the answer to your question is that when you look at history, when people are in existential crisis, they tend to act. They tend to organize. And I think it is for the left and for progressives to lead that energy in good directions, because the right and the populist movements on the right are trying to harness that same energy. And that's a very, very, that's a very dangerous phenomenon. So I think we're in a moment of peril, but we're also in a moment, I think, of real hope and opportunity for progressive people.
I agree. Kshama, did you want to add anything to that?
I just really, again, appreciate what Joel said. Yeah, and I was just starting with the last point he made, which is that the threat of right populism, much less the far right. I mean, this is a real danger. We've seen this come into play through the victory of Trump in the last election. And obviously this was historically important that the American voters delivered a repudiating message, rejecting his reactionary agenda, his anti-worker, anti-woman, anti-immigrant agenda. But at the same time, the fact that a con man like him could even come to power, that shows the real threat of right populism. And the reason they have gained ground is precisely because there's a vacuum. There's an anger at corporate politics, anger at the system. And unless the left gets organized, especially the socialist left has a serious responsibility on our shoulders, unless we get organized and present a political alternative to all of this, we're going to see further threats of right populism. And for example, in the US, Trump may be defeated, but Trumpism is far from defeated. And as long as you have the only alternative to Republicans in the right wing, for example, in the US, being the Democratic establishment, which may have differences from the Republicans, but ultimately serves the same masters, which is Wall Street and the capitalist class and the system of capitalism, you're going to see that kind of growth. And that's why, for example, just concretely, Socialist Alternative and I in the United States, we are strongly arguing that the working class in the US needs its own political organization. We need a working class party that will be a real alternative to these sort of two wings of big business, two wings of the system, which are represented by Republicans and Democrats, despite their differences. And I think you can see similar challenges elsewhere. I mean, just to pick the example of India, I mean, obviously India is going through an apocalyptic crisis right now, as Anjali, you mentioned. But look at the situation, right? Modi and the BJP, the anger against them is absolutely, I'm sure if you did a poll, it would be record numbers, because look at the kind of chaos and loss of life and just the impact on millions of people's lives. Absolutely, if today there was a working class political organization, you know, waiting to actually build real links with the broad majority in India and really provide an alternative to not only Modi and the BJP, but the Congress Party and all these different wings of the Indian ruling class, then we could actually have made some kind of, real serious inroads into politics and a real, pose the question of a real defeat to Modi. And this is part two. Modi and the BJP also faced serious anger during the demonetization fiasco several years ago. And then again, Modi came into power because there was nobody to present an alternative. And you're going to see this again and again. But on the other hand, what we should derive hope from is that there's a huge opening. This is not a moment to lament that people are not ready for this message. People are very much ready. What's missing is this leadership on the left, is this message that we really need to unite against the inequities of the system. And just one concrete example I'll mention in closing is, the kind of incredible opposition from ordinary people worldwide against the vaccine nationalism and vaccine apartheid, and that leading to, real victory, forcing the Biden regime to back down on, opposing the WTO patent, removing the patent restrictions. Obviously, we have a long way to go still, but that shows you that people around the world understand that our fates are interlinked with one another.
Thank you so much. I think that's actually a really great note to wind down on. And, there is so much to dig into here, and this could warrant hours more of conversation, but I really appreciate the points that you've made about needing to lean into our unity and have that kind of and call for that kind of strong leadership that highlights that unity from the left. We do need to wind down and wrap up, although there's so much more I want to ask. And I know a lot of people have put questions into the question box. If Joel and Kshama didn't touch on your question and what they said, I really invite you to send me the question as a follow-up. My email address is anjali@sierraclub.bc.ca. And any follow-up comments and questions, and I'll do my best to get back to you as much as possible. I just want to ask Joel and Kshama to just close with a very quick answer to just a very simple yet huge question. And it's what is giving you hope right now? And I'll just ask those to be your closing comments, and then we'll just give the audience some next steps and close.
I don't think either of us are capable of a quick answer. But anyways, I've never been. The quick answer to that is, I think just as we're seeing corporate power reaching heights that we've never seen before, we're also seeing activism, the BLM protests in the wake of the murder of George Floyd, the kind of thing that Kshama's doing in Seattle, the kids protesting climate change. I mean, we're just seeing uprisings around the world, indigenous people fighting for their rights in the Amazon, in British Columbia. We're seeing uprisings around the world. And I truly believe that capitalism is very vulnerable at this moment, because I think that the myths that have sustained it for the last couple hundred years are so out of sync with reality that people just don't believe it anymore. The superstructure is no longer legitimating the base in anybody who has their eyes open. And I think, you know, again, when you look at history, when you're in those moments, things change.
I love that. That is a vision of hope. Thank you so much, Joel. Kshama gives you hope.
I think it would probably be very much along the lines of what Joel was saying, that really we are in a period when just tens of millions and probably hundreds of millions of people around the world are really looking for a fundamental shift in their lives, in society, in the way it's run, because they can see, no matter what vocabulary they use, they may not speak in terms of capitalism versus socialism, but what they understand is what they see around them is completely broken and needs to be changed. I mean, in fact, the only reason, the fact that the Black Lives Matter protests were so huge and became a global phenomenon was not only the question of oppression, and specifically Black oppression, which it was obviously that was a paramount question, but it also captured the overall anger and resentment at the status quo and really captured a burning desire for social change. And I would say one thing is, the one mistake we could make is not being hopeful, because it is not being hopeful or thinking that people are not ready for change that will keep us paralyzed in a previous period. You know, this is not the period of, the kind of demonizing and vilifying of socialism. I mean, obviously the ruling class will do that, but the point is that people are ready for a shift. The planet is crying out for a shift. And it's not going to exist for much longer unless we fight back. But the one thing we can do wrong is become pessimistic and not understand that there are these huge openings and not really making sure that we use those openings to bring about the kind of historic change that is being called for.
Yes, thank you so much. You heard it from Joel and Kshama. Now is the time and our moment is now. There are several things you can do in this moment going forward. Kshama's links have been dropped in the chat by David Ng of Hello Cool World. Maybe I can just drop those in again to support Kshama's solidarity campaign. You can book a screening of the film like what we did tonight. And there's a link to do that. David, if you can see this, can you drop that link again? You can also follow up at the email address I put in the chat. We would love to dive into this more. We think that being able to use this language to understand what we're up against and understand how the corporation is so tied to the state and how it influences everything that we are working towards and working against right now. This is climate justice. And so if you want to hear more conversations like this, please, I would love to hear your feedback. Please do email me and I'd love to keep this conversation going. Thank you so much once again, Joel and Kshama. I also want to put two more links in the chat from my amazing team, Maya and Aurora. If you want to get involved right now, we have a new portal where we want everybody's gifts, everybody's unique gifts to be a part of this movement. And so you can go to the website and choose what you can uniquely contribute, and we'll be in touch from there. So I'll just put that link in there. It's invitetoaction.ca. And please, if you want to support more free movie screenings like this, you can always donate to Sierra Club BC, and we would appreciate that very much. So thank you so much once again, Joel and Kshama. We really are honored to have you here.
Thank you.
Is there anything else that you'd like to direct people's attention to before we end our discussion here? All right, well, I have one more thing. And this is, we're not talking about corporations anymore. Tomorrow is a very special person's birthday. It's Joel Bakan's birthday tomorrow. So if you can put your happy birthday messages in the chat and make Joel feel very special.
Thank you. Thank you very much. I appreciate that.
So thank you so much.
And it's really been an honor to be with the two of you. It's just been great. I've really enjoyed it. Thank you.
Thank you. Look at all your birthday messages, Joel. So I'm gonna serenade us out with a great song by a local incredible Mohawk artist, Kinney Star. And feel free to send messages on your way out. And thank you once again, Joel and Kshama.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Thank you so much. Thank you, Joel, and happy birthday. Thank you, Anjali.
Thank you. Thanks, Kshama. Bye-bye.
Fires are burning in the rain. Please come and take my hand again. Feed the fire. Feed the fire. It'll all come up again.
My own, probably.
She knows the best of things, and she knows the worst of things, and she can see anything about anything, and it don't matter about a damn thing.